While Alec Ross was working as senior advisor for innovation to the Secretary of State, he traveled to 41 countries, touring the latest advances coming out of every continent. From startup hubs in Kenya to R&D labs in South Korea, Ross has seen what the future holds. In the industries of the future, Ross shows us what changes are coming in the next 10 years, highlighting the best opportunities for progress and explaining why countries thrive or sputter. He examines the specific fields that will most shape our economic future, including robotics, cybersecurity, the commercialization of genomics, the next step for big data, and the coming impact of digital technology on money and markets. Forbes.com's review of this book says that the industries of the future reads like a portable TED conference at which you have been seated next to the smartest guy in the room. The book is filled with glimpses of cutting-edge biotech research, statecraft, and entrepreneurship. Ross uses his unique set of experiences to weave these disparate stories into a picture of the next decades of innovation. Eric Schmidt, CEO of Google and author of The New Digital Age, says, "In a world growing more chaotic, Alec Ross is one of those very rare people who can see patterns in the chaos and guidance for the road forward. He's an unusual diversity of expertise that allows him to apply multiple lenses to the world's challenges and dream up the kind of innovative solutions that are changing the world." Alec is currently a distinguished visiting fellow at Johns Hopkins University. Alec serves as an advisor to investors, corporations, government leaders to help them understand the implication of factors emergent at the intersection of geopolitics, markets, and increasingly disruptive network technology. Ross recently served for 4 years as a senior advisor for innovation to Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, a role created for him by Secretary Clinton to maximize the potential of technology and innovation in service of America's diplomatic agenda. In 2000, he and three colleagues co-founded the technology-focused nonprofit organization One Economy and grew it from modest origins in a basement into a global organization serving millions of low-income people with programs on four continents. Alec has served as a guest lecturer at numerous institutions, including United Nations, Oxford University, Harvard Law School, Stanford Business School, and a number of parliamentary bodies. His writing has appeared in academic publications, including the Johns Hopkins SAIS Review of International Affairs and the NATO Review. Alec started his career as a sixth grade teacher through Teach for America in the inner city, Baltimore, where he currently lives with his wife and their three young children. So if you will, please join me in welcoming Alec Ross.
All right. Well, thank you for that awfully nice introduction. You read it just like my mother wrote it. I wanted to sort of start this talking about why I wrote the book. I wrote this book because when I was graduating from college in 1994, that was when much of what we now know of as the internet was really taking off. I mean, it was effectively the beginning of e-commerce, the beginning of the search engine. It was when the internet went from being this thing which was essentially a bulletin board for geeks to becoming accessible to what would eventually become a couple billion people. And I wish I had read a book in 1994 that said, hey, there's this thing called the internet, and here's what it's going to do over the next 20 years. And so the point of departure for me in writing The Industries of the Future is to say, all right, well, if the story of the last 20 years was the story of the rise of the internet and digitization, what's next? And if the internet so shaped the world over the last 20 years, what is going to shape the world over the next 10 to 20? And so what I wanted to do, I didn't want to give, you know, a very long set of remarks up top, because I find that in settings like this, the discussion in the Q&A can be more interesting than prepared remarks up top. So what I wanted to do was give sort of a thin gloss over some of the key theses that emerged in my writing. Key thesis number one: land was the raw material of the agricultural age. Iron was the raw material of the industrial age. Data is the raw material of the information age. He who owned the land and controlled the land during the agricultural age amassed the economic power and the political power. He who owned the factories and controlled access to the natural resources during the industrial age had the economic power and the political power. Today, in today and tomorrow's world, he or she who own the data, control the data, or can harvest meaning from the data are those that are creating the industries and businesses of the future. Now, in an audience as sophisticated as this, I wouldn't presume to sort of give a primer of what data analytics is. I'm sure you all understand big data, what it is, and what it can do. But a couple facts that may be unknown to you that you might find interesting. 90% of the world's data, 90% of the world's information has been produced in the last 2 years. 90% of all of the data produced over the course of humanity has been produced since February of 2015. And in fact, if you take the sum of all of the information, all of the data produced from the earliest recordings of humankind, literally the paintings on cave walls, from paintings on cave walls to the year 2003, not that long ago, the sum of all the information produced from paintings on cave walls to the year 2003, we now produce every 2 days. Every 2 days, we produce as much information as was produced over that span of history. And we do that through what is right now, in February of 2017, about 20 billion network devices. So there are about 20 billion devices out there sending or receiving a signal. This is the sum of our smartphones, our internet-connected laptops, the sensors in our supply chains. In 3 years, which is, again, not that long from now, February of 2020, that number will have grown from an estimated 20 billion to about 45 billion. So the slope in the graph and digitization is going sort of remaining wildly and steeply upward. But what's most interesting to me about going from 20 billion to 45 billion is we're not doing that by putting more mobile phones in more pockets. What's interesting is that the next stage of digitization is going to build is an industrial internet. So the internet that we've built so far has largely, the industries that it's largely turned inside out are rooted in information communication services. So things like advertising, journalism, even running for election. Things where the principal good or service is rooted in information or communications, that's really what's changed the most in the last wave of digitization. But what's interesting about what's to come over the next 3 to 5 years is what we're going to be doing is we're going to be running computer code, zeros and ones, through things which to this point largely haven't been animated by computer code. We're going to be turning inside out industries like transportation, mining, things that we think of as sort of the old industrial economy are going to be modernized by bringing zeros and ones into and through it. And I think that this is going to create an enormous number of changes that are both good and bad. You know, most people who write books about the future, they're either utopian or they're dystopian. You know, it's either, oh, we're going to live to be 150 years old, happy, healthy, wealthy, and lacking for nothing, utopian, or it's sort of eyes closed, fist clenched, bedwetting dystopianism, right? Star Trek or Mad Max. And I think, in my analysis is that the future is not going to be utopian. The future is not going to be dystopian. It's a little bit more up the middle. And that all of these changes in technology and science are going to contribute to both the promise and peril of our future. And as I think about our building an industrial internet, and as I think about what's to come with the commercialization of genomics and other such fields, I think that that's what we're going to see, promise and peril. And I think that life will be net better, but not net better for everyone. And this has been brought to life for me in a couple ways. One story, which does not reflect well on me, but I'm going to tell anyway, has to do with the driverless car. When I first heard about the idea of an autonomous vehicle, a driverless car, I'm not going to lie, I thought it was insane. And I happened to run into the Google founders at an event, and I said to them, I said, guys, I'm going to short your stock. I said, look, you're obviously too rich, you're too bored, and you obviously are not doing drug testing at Google. I said, you know, there's not going to be a driverless car. This is a few years ago. And what they said, you know, before you short our stock, you know, next time you're in California, come by the Googleplex and actually look at what we're doing. And so I did that. Like 2 months later, I was in California. I was in the Valley, so I went to Mountain View, and I went to check out what they were doing. And one of the founders, let's call him Google Guy One. Google Guy One was waiting for me in the parking lot. And he sort of showed me the car. And, you know, I looked inside, and sure enough, there was no steering wheel. And he opens the back door for me, and he's like, get inside. So I got inside. And he goes, put on your seatbelt. So I put on my seatbelt. And then he had this sort of shit-eating grin that you can have when you're worth $30 billion. And he sort of closes the door. He closes the door. And we then, the car then begins driving shortly, slowly around the parking lot. And I've got three kids, 10, 12, and 14 years old. And my thought at the time was, this is like one of those kiddie rides at Ocean City that my kids are now too old for. So I'm like, congratulations, guys, you just spent $1 billion creating a kiddie ride. But then the car pulled out of the parking lot and went on the road. And it started going faster, like 20 miles an hour, 30 miles an hour, 40 miles an hour. And then it got on the ramp to 101, going north on 101. 40 miles an hour, 50 miles an hour. Now we're on 101. We're changing lanes. And again, I am thinking of my three children at this point. And, you know, people, as we're driving, like, again, there's nobody else in the car. There's no steering wheel. We're changing lanes, and people are noticing, like, oh, it's one of those driverless cars. So cars are like, hey, you know, looking at us and almost running into us. And I'm thinking to myself, like, somebody's going to die. I'm like, either I'm going to die, or somehow I'm going to live, and I'm going to then go kill one of the Google guys. And I was freaked out. Like, this was not one of my prouder moments. But you can only be so freaked out for so long. And after like 10 minutes of changing lanes and doing this and doing that, I was like, oh my God, it works. And eventually we pull off and we sort of loop around so that we can get back on 101 going south. And it takes me back to the Googleplex. And Google Guy One is waiting there for me with his shit-eating grin and sort of looks at me as I get out. And he's like, so you still going to short my stock? And, you know, when I think about this, this then led to about a year and a half of studying autonomous vehicles. And the conclusion that I came to is that all of the things that people say are going to happen in 10 to 15 years are actually going to happen in 3 to 5 years. In part because this is not the Google car anymore. Every car maker views augmented or autonomous vehicles as their future. And the barriers right now to doing this are less technological than they are regulatory and cultural. And, you know, as I think about, you know, the promise and peril of this, on the promise side, I think about the 1.6 million people who die in car accidents every year. And know that if we're going to put driverless cars on the street, they absolutely positively have to be substantially safer than cars driven by human beings. I also think about the extraordinary amount of time that we waste actually driving and thinking about, hey, taking that time which is relatively wasted where we could be sitting in the back seat reading, doing whatever else, and making it more active time. But on the side of peril, I think about the single largest occupation for men in the United States. 3 million men in the United States make their living driving a motor vehicle. And if you think about it, the people who are driving the tractor trailers on the interstate, the FedEx trucks, the UPS trucks, these are some of the few remaining really good middle class jobs available to people without a university degree. So promise and peril. You know, I also think as we go from a world of 20 billion network devices to 40 billion network devices, about what we're going to be able to do in the sciences. I think that the world's last trillion-dollar industry was made out of computer code. The world's next trillion-dollar industry is going to be made out of genetic code. And so another area that I focus a lot in the book about is exploring what we can do harvesting data out of the 20 to 25,000 genes that are in all of our bodies. And this was really brought to life for me by a guy who I played racquetball with, who for the longest time I thought was just a gym rat. This guy with like this great big gray beard, wears this sort of nasty old headband, a knee brace on the outside of his like 1970s style gray sweatpants. And for a couple years, I thought this guy was just a gym rat. Turns out, this guy, Dr. Bert Vogelstein, is the world's most cited living scientist. It was his team at Johns Hopkins working with a handful of other institutions that figured out back in the 1980s how mutations in proteins cause cancer. Kind of a big deal. And what Dr. Vogelstein explained to me, he said, you know, Alec, when you go for your annual checkup and you get blood taken, what gets measured right now? I'm like, well, I think things like my cholesterol level and stuff like that. And he goes, well, if you give me that same vial of blood and $4,000, I can sequence the genetic material within it, and I can identify cancerous cells at 1/100th the size of what can be detected by an MRI. I can find cancerous cells very early in stage one, before you feel badly at all, before you're at all symptomatic, and when it's much more curable than the stages 3 and 4 where we routinely find cancers. Now, this process is called a liquid biopsy. Raise your hand if you've ever had a liquid biopsy. Okay, that's my billionaire's test. So none of you are billionaires, okay? And the reason for that is if any of you were billionaires, your hands would be up. Because the people who get these tests done right now are very wealthy. And the reason why they get them done, the reason why you have to be very wealthy is because the year before it cost $4,000, it cost $14,000. And the year before that, it costs $40,000. And you know, a test you take when you are not feeling badly is not something that expensive, is not going to be done unless you're wealthy. But here's the thing. At the time that I interviewed him for this book, it was $4,000. Now it's $1,400, more accessible. In about 18 months, it could be $400. In the next 3 to 5 years, this test could be a routine part of all of our annual checkups if you have good health insurance. And this doesn't cure cancer, but what it does is it makes certain kinds of cancer substantially less fatal. And I think that what this will effectively mean is that for young people, today's teenagers in the United States, the developments in this field could add 3 to 5 years of life expectancy for them. But in the same way in which we can use all of this genetic data to do early diagnostics, and in the same way in which we can increasingly make incisions into who we are within our DNA to repair our DNA to keep things, to keep our negative predispositions from manifesting themselves into disease and illness, so too can we use this for cosmetic reasons. And so I asked Dr. Vogelstein's partner, you know, I was getting very excited about this, and I said, what's the downside for all of this work that we can do with our genetic data? And what he said, he goes, designer babies. He goes, the same way in which we are going to be able to go into DNA still in embryo and repair damaged DNA, which might give somebody a higher predisposition to something like, say, Huntington's disease or Parkinson's, so too could we make the kinds of incisions that would say, huh, blue eyes, I really wanted my kid to have brown eyes. Or he's expected to be 5'6", 5'7". Are there some things that we could do to make him a little taller? So all of the kinds of things that we can do intervening genetically, which I think we would find to be overwhelmingly acceptable, intervening to reduce the likelihood of disease or other chronic illnesses, so too could we use that for what we might consider to be cosmetic purposes. Another thing that I think is really interesting is, as we go from a world of 20 billion network devices to 45 billion network devices, where a lot of people are focusing on surveillance, I think we have to increasingly be concerned about surveillance. So a lot of people are worried about GCHQ and the NSA and the Russians and this and that. But that's reasonable. But where I think our privacy is much more likely to be compromised than by the NSA or GCHQ is from everybody with a video-enabled cell phone, and or all of the data, all of the digital fingerprints that we leave within the opt-in use that we have with, you know, the appification of our lives. And the story that I tell in the book that I think really brought this out for me is an app called Good to Go. And the designers of Good to Go came at this with positive intentions. What they were trying to do with Good to Go was develop an app to respond to the crisis of sexual assault on college campuses and among young professionals, where literally you, on this app, you demonstrate affirmative consent, something called affirmative consent, where it basically says, yes, I am ready to have sex. I'm okay with this. And so what's fascinating about this is where it's well-intentioned and it codifies it, you know, where you are. There's even a tube where it can measure your blood alcohol level. What's interesting about it is if you read the terms of service for the Good to Go app, they absolutely have the right to sell your data and they do not have to anonymize it. So theoretically, if somebody practiced affirmative consent 3 or 4 times, they could say, oh yes, Maria practiced affirmative consent, you know, these 4 times. She did so at these 3 bars. She did so at 10:10 p.m., 10:45 p.m., 11:10 p.m. Her blood alcohol level on those 4 dates was the following. And so what's fascinating about this is, just guess. I mean, imagine that information gets into the wild. And we know that that which can be hacked more often than not eventually will be hacked. And it, you know, while somebody's sort of blink reaction might be automatically negative to that, like there's no positive to that, the one thing that I would draw out as being potentially positive that comes from all of this transparency, sort of good and bad, is I do think we're going to see a shift in norms in some fascinating ways as privacy erodes. And the way that I think about this, I think about like drug use by presidential candidates. So in 1991, the question of whether Bill Clinton inhaled, like did he inhale? Like this was an existential question for his campaign. You know, if he inhaled, then he was not fit to be president. You know, fast forward 16 years later, I'm working on the Obama campaign and Senator Obama's like, oh, I inhaled. I inhaled a lot. I liked it. And hey, I snorted Coke too. Non-issue. What happened in those 16 years? What happened in those 16 years is norms shifted. I think about homosexuality on college campuses. I don't think of myself as old. I'm in my 40s. But when I was in college, homosexuality was still viewed as this strange, aberrant behavior. It's like, that's the gay guy. Now, 20 years later, homosexuality is overwhelmingly accepted on college campuses like the one that I attended, and the idea that would somehow be aberrant behavior or behavior that's out of the norm doesn't make any sense. What happened in those 20 years? Norms shifted. So one thing that I think, again, it's going to be both good and bad, is as more of our lives become codified in sort of indelible digital ink, I think that norms are going to continue to shift, and we're going to understand and accept human fallibility in new and interesting ways. So look, with that, I'll close off my remarks up top. The book sort of gives a vast sweep, looking at both the technological and scientific innovations that I think are going to be most interesting over the next 10 years, but also trying to look as closely as possible at what the impact is going to be on geopolitics and on culture. So saying, all right, you know, how does all of this emerge on the 196 country chessboard? And what are the attributes that different states and societies are going to need to be able to flourish in a world where, with all of these changes to come, and what are the conditions in states and societies that will cause them to founder? So with that, I'd welcome whatever questions you may have. As Davis mentioned, I did have a run at the State Department as a diplomat. I'm not a diplomat anymore, so please feel free to ask undiplomatic questions. Those can be the most interesting. And how are we going to do questions?
I think we got it.
Okay.
Yeah, that sounds
it's working
good.
Now. So that's great. Swap with me. You can take it off.
Right here?
Yes, ma'am.
Just prior to attending this discussion, I attended a discussion by another author introducing his book called Fraud, An American History from Barnum to Madoff. Would you comment on the jurisdictional power across borders and enforcement cooperation for the future of fraud, or should I say fraud prevention?
Yeah, I mean, so it's difficult because the structures and strictures that we used historically are fragmenting. You know, international law, focusing for a moment on that which I understand best, which is how this works in the digital sphere, because increasingly fraud will be perpetrated through these communications networks. There is very little in the way of treaties. There's very little in the way of cooperative agreements in this cyber domain. Part of how we lose about $300 billion a year in intellectual property theft from China because of hacking of intellectual property in the United States is because the enforcement mechanisms are lacking. So there are big multilateral bodies like the World Trade Organization. You know, there are other ways in which these things can be litigated, but given the disparate degree to which states, including, oh, by the way, the United States, will or will not conform to decisions made by multilateral international bodies, it makes it more difficult to enforce a kind of set of uniform set of standards or laws or rules of the road where we see a balkanization of regulatory and statutory authorities. Oh yeah, I'm completely pessimistic in this respect. Yeah, no, it's big, you know, they're like, again, thinking about what I know best, which is the internet and like internet governance, there's really no way in which I think that there's gonna be any sort of effective treaty making to which the United States, China, and Russia will all be a party. In part because every state looks to the United States to say, all right, will you stop surveilling? You know, will you commit to not using our communications networks for mass surveillance and communications intercepts? And we say, no. And we say, will you commit to not steal commercial internet, commercial intellectual property? And they say, no. The Russians say, yeah, we'll say yes to anything, but we don't really care, you know? So yeah, there isn't enough shared space in the Venn diagram, I think, to really do effective treaty making or agreement making here.
When a lot of people talk about computers and stuff automating jobs, they're often talking about a lot of blue-collar jobs, like driverless cars replacing taxi drivers and, you know, truck drivers. But what about AI's potential to also replace and automate a lot of even white-collar jobs, whether it's, you know, dealing with basic decision-making, mortgage underwriting, insurance claims, even going forward like that? What effect do you think that's going to have?
Yeah, so I write a significant amount about that. I think that, I mean, sort of the way I think about it, the robots of the cartoons and movies from the 1970s are going to be the reality of the 2020s because of cloud robotics enabled by AI and because of advancements in mapping belief space. And what that will mean effectively is that that labor substitution that typically has been manual and routine, you know, the work of men with strong shoulders working ports, factories, mines, or mills, or even the work of the bank teller or of the person who gives you your boarding pass or who drives your FedEx truck, it's still work that can be characterized as in large respects as manual and routine. But what AI will enable is labor substitution that is cognitive and non-routine. So work done by people with white shirts and red ties right now. And so this, I think, is going to present some really interesting challenges. Like my father, a country lawyer in Hurricane, West Virginia. You know, for 40 years, my father worked. I love my father, but at the end of the day, all he did for 40 years is connect really large stacks of paper that people would sign when they spend 2 hours signing when they bought or sold a home. And still, to this day, if you buy or sell a home, the process, it feels like you're in the 1970s. The buyer wants to buy, the seller wants to sell. They say, that's great, we'll see you in 6 weeks. You know, the closing costs are gonna be like $9,000. You sit down and there's a bunch of, you know, ink stamps. There's a lot of signatures. Like, that doesn't make sense. And so AI combined with things like blockchain technology is going to take that 6 week process and make it a 6 hour process and take it from being a $9,000 closing cost to being a $190 closing cost. And in so doing, reduce the friction. And in the friction in this case is the real estate lawyer, the accountant, you know, anybody who is sort of in the middle of that transaction. And so there's a lot of that kind of labor that I think is going to be eaten by software.
Hi, quick question about the Google Translate thing. Did you hear about that recently, that that its own AI invented its own language to speed this up? At what point is there a possibility that there's something that has to be stopped?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So, and Google actually, some of my friends at Google right now, what they're actually trying to develop is an off button. You know, when can you turn AI off? The ability of AI to become self-correcting is not something I'm worried about. The ability of AI to become what we would call self-aware and be able to do things defensively to keep its code from being, to keep it from being coded in a way which limits its proficiencies is something that we ought to be thinking about right now before it becomes a problem. And so some people in the private sector are already working on this. Reid Hoffman, Peter Thiel, Elon Musk, and a handful of others recently made a combined $1 billion investment in something they're calling AI, the purpose of which is basically to make sure there's AI for good. And the people who are really the best AI experts at Google, Demis Hassabis and the guys from DeepMind, a lot of their work right now is on creating sort of rules for how do you govern AI as it grows exponentially more powerful. For me, the question becomes, at what point does the AI begin to have characteristics that look like self-awareness? Now, we're not there yet, but you have to actually anticipate that and then think about what is the off button? You know, what is the way in which, if you are putting boundaries on its capabilities, you know, how can you keep it from sort of taking the governor off itself? It's really interesting. It's slightly scary.
Alec, thank you for attending and being here. One of the issues you wrote about in your book was on currency and and the future of money, and specifically fintech. And I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on blockchain, Bitcoin, et cetera, and where you think the future is going in that direction.
Yeah, thank you. So I think of Bitcoin like one of those search engines from the 1990s. You know, InfoSeek, Lycos, AltaVista, WebCrawler. Do any of you remember any of those old search engines? You know, they all went to zero. But there was the 18th search engine was Google. And while all of those search engines went to zero, the category of search became more powerful than ever. I do think, when I think of Bitcoin, I think that Bitcoin may very well eventually go to zero. But I think that the vertical, the category of a cryptocurrency makes more sense than ever. And I think that if you basically fix some of the problems, what I would consider to be the problems that keep Bitcoin from scaling, those are solvable problems. And I do think that it wouldn't surprise me if there is a successor cryptocurrency to Bitcoin that is not anonymous or pseudonymous, that has controls within the blockchain that keep from certain kinds of manipulation that are possible within Bitcoin, where I could imagine in 8, 9, 10 years, the dominant currencies globally are the dollar, the yen, the yuan, the euro, and some cryptocurrency we haven't heard of yet. Because I do think that, while I think that there are enormous flaws with Bitcoin specifically, I do think that the blockchain technology within it is brilliant and is a spectacular innovation in computer science. And it's interesting that it's interesting to see the evolution of thinking in this. I've had three different conversations with Lloyd Blankfein, the CEO of Goldman Sachs, about Bitcoin. And I think that seeing how he responded to this is illuminating. So the first time I asked him about Bitcoin, he goes, Bitcoin, criminals, he goes, it's horrible, we gotta stop them. Then the second time I asked him about it, he goes, yeah, some people are saying they have to work at them. I'm like, fine, you can work on the Bitcoin, but you gotta do your other work too. And then the third conversation I had with him, he goes, yeah, we like some of this technology in it, the blockchains, you know. And then like a month after that last conversation with him, they filed a patent for something called Settlecoin, which basically is basically a walled garden for asset settlements that will enable them to move money even more efficiently between themselves and their key clients in China with less friction. So I think what's ironic about this is that Bitcoin was created in many respects, was created by people who are anti-statist and anti-establishment, but ultimately it might be the states and the establishment adopting the core technology within it, blockchain, which scales it, which I think would probably cause them enormous distress.
Alec, thank you so much for your talk. I think over the last year, the chattering classes and the conversation about artificial intelligence has really pressed the sort of I believe button, right? We've got Westworld, and we've got The Economist, and we've got The Wall Street Journal, and the Financial Times all doing big reports on the importance of AI and robotics and how much it's going to change society. And when you think about that Oxford Martin School study, the 47% of American jobs are up for automation in the next 2 decades. When you think about that and the things that you see out there, what is the time frame and what is till there's a tipping point here versus sort of local specific incidences of automation?
Yeah, I mean, I think that AI is gonna be one of those things where we overestimate what's gonna happen in the short term, where we overestimate what's gonna happen in the short term and underestimate what's gonna happen in the long term. So I do think that most of this AI right now is really crude. People have the enthusiasm around AI that reminds me of sort of a lot of the dot-com excitement in like 1995, 1996. It lacked the scale, the processing power, and other such things to really be able to change markets in the way that was imagined then. But what happened is 10 years later, it did prove true. And so I think that that's the way it's going. I think that that's the way AI is going to evolve. I mean, if you actually sort of geek into what would be needed in terms of structuring some of the unstructured data sets to be able to have you know, smart real-time AI doing things that are cognitive and non-routine, you know, in the workplace, you know, most of the estimates I see is being sort of between 8 and 12 years. So from my standpoint, what then becomes really important is how do we prepare ourselves as human beings for this? You know, humans are not as easy to update as software. And so my obsession really since writing this book has been on focusing on, all right, if the timeline is 3 years, 10 years, or 15 years, regardless of where it is, you know, how do we future-proof ourselves and how do we future-proof our kids in a world where more labor is being done by zeros and ones that previously would have been done by, you know, carbon-based life forms? What are the areas where there will be job growth? What are the areas that will be immune to substitution by AI? So that's where my head has been lately.
Hi. So I did a project. I'm working on the book myself, so congratulations for completing a book, because I know that's difficult. I did a thing where I traveled around the world and asked people the same three questions, and two of my questions were, in your opinion, what is the biggest threat to humanity today? And then what do you think the world will be like 50 years from now? So not the 10, a little bit longer view, but still enough that people could see themselves within it and kind of answer accordingly. And I felt like at this, I went to 40 countries and asked over 700 people, and I felt like there was an energy that was really concerned about the direction that we're headed as a planet, you know, across continents, just like this either or moment, and technology being kind of one of these, it's expediting the direction that we're going or the way that things can move. You know, I heard like the whole World War III will be fought, you know, with like the technology, but World War IV with sticks and stones, you know, the way that quote that's out there. But one of the biggest threats I heard, I only heard singularity three times, but one of the biggest threats was just human characteristics constantly, like greed and power. And I guess that I know it's not your focus for your research focus, but with everything that you know about how technology can just, you know, how quickly technology can change things, and with this whole thing that you just said about humans interacting with technology, to make it an undiplomatic question, do you worry that some of the leaders of today have a power that is enormous, or is, you know, they don't have to look in the face of an enemy to make a big decision, or, you know, there's even population growth and how we're handling the resources that we have on this planet. Like, do you worry about those human characteristics who are the decision makers impacting our future in a way that any projection could be disrupted in a really catastrophic way?
Sure. I mean, I think, first of all, none of these technologies are as destructive as nuclear power. And I think it's reasonable for us to worry about nuclear conflict, because this is a case where, you know, somebody pushes a red button and the scale of death is extraordinary. So none of these technologies that I'm talking about are as scary as the weaponization of fissile material. The difference, though, is that the number of individuals, I mean, literally just the number of individuals who are capable of creating death on a mass scale because of their access to and tactical command of being able to use nuclear weapons has always been very small. And so the difference between then and now, while there aren't necessarily the mass killers that there is with the weaponization of fissile material, what there is there's a substantially lower barrier to entry to people being able to use like weaponized code or other such things. And so I do worry about that, and I worry about it too because so much of the activity is no longer governed by states. You know, if you think about what the mass killers, what the things are that could have, that would have created the biggest body count in the past, it was always a sovereign nation state that was in charge. But what increasingly we see is with the rise of non-state-based actors that aren't going to have accountability to an electorate or to a constituency of any kind, that's more worrisome. Where I would imagine, like, if we are talking about a legitimately long time horizon, then the thing that scares me more than weaponized code and which scares me more than AI is genetically modified viruses, genetically modified bacteria, which can create, bacterial illnesses which we are not prepared for. Right now, the capability for doing that is domiciled in a very, very, very small number of institutions, and we don't really have to worry about them. But knowledge always diffuses. And in the same way in which somebody like A.Q. Khan had expertise in weaponizing fissile material and making states that we don't want to be nuclear powers, enabling them to become nuclear powers, so too do I worry that if we get to the point where our sophistication about being able to weaponize bacterial or viral matter suddenly becomes more broadly accessible to people outside very, very, very small clusters of scientific expertise, then that actually worries me more about than the singularity or weaponized code. Yes, sir.
Thank you for the talk and the book. Two follow-up questions to questions that were asked earlier. One, you mentioned we have to look at what sectors or industries that jobs will be growing in. So could you tell us what you think those are? And then secondly, on the future of money, I'm curious to double-click on your continued optimism around cryptocurrency. So the analogy you described of Lloyd Blankenfeld and Goldman, they're using blockchain for internal settlements, a very kind of old school, traditional financial service being updated with technology, but nothing nearly as kind of, from a regulatory and legal perspective, separate and unique as like a Bitcoin. So would be curious as to why you're still, or what you see that continues to make you optimistic about cryptocurrency versus blockchain technology.
Yes, so let me answer your second question first. What makes me optimistic about it is a nation state like Sweden, Sweden, which is becoming a cash-free economy, if they chose to adopt blockchain within its currency, and prove that it could work, like I could see a Singapore or a Sweden, with all of the in God we trust authority that flows through a traditional nation state, saying our currency is an option with our currency to facilitate capital flows in and with our country, will be a cryptocurrency, and if it leverages the best computer science to make sure that it has, that it's enabled with the most secure blockchain technology, I could see it taking off. It's really about, in my opinion, having a nation state choose strategically to make it its own. And your first question again? Right, so this, I think the idea of a stateless cryptocurrency would be, it's not impossible, it's really not. If I were one of these libertarian VCs in Silicon Valley, there's actually, I think it's worth taking a shot at trying to create a stateless cryptocurrency, but which meets some of the regulatory burdens placed on it by nation states. And that really comes down to the currency being rooted in real identity. If somebody is willing to develop a cryptocurrency which is rooted in real identity, which is the exact opposite in part of why Bitcoin was created, I actually think the irony is that it would take off. Yeah, the job. What areas do I think that there will be job growth in? Well, there have actually been a fair number of studies that I think demonstrate pretty clearly where job growth will be. The tricky bit is if you look, for example, over a next 5-year horizon, it's no matter how you cut it, it's a net decrease. So if you just look at automation, the projections over the next 5 years is that there are going to be 7.1 million jobs lost to automation, and about 2.1 million jobs gained because of the wide-scale adoption of these and related technologies. You're still upside down 5 million jobs, so it's impossible to put an intellectually honest, pretty picture on this. And part of the trick, too, is it's easier to imagine the jobs that are going to be lost than the jobs that are going to be gained. When the mechanization of the farm began to take place, it was impossible to tell the young people who grew up on a farm but who are going to have to then make their living in a city, you know, what the areas of job growth were going to be. Rather than identifying the specific jobs that I think will continue to grow, because there are plenty of studies on that, let me say what I think some of the common attributes are going to be. And that is that they're going to be increasingly interdisciplinary. So people focus a lot on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and that's fine. If you're a good coder, if you have domain expertise in something scientific or technological, it's reasonable to assume that you're going to have relatively steady middle-class employment. But if you actually want to be a leader in that world, one of the things that I think is most interesting is that I think that the leaders in that world will be people who have an understanding of things that are scientific and technological, but it will also be married up with aptitudes or domain expertise in what we associate with the humanities. Emotional intelligence, good communication skills, an understanding of behavioral psychology. You know, I think Facebook is an example of this. You know, people think of Facebook as the product of, you know, this smart computer scientist, computer science student from Harvard, Mark Zuckerberg. But what people don't realize is that Mark also had a second area that he was concentrating his studies in, behavioral psychology. And I think Facebook is as much a byproduct of Mark Zuckerberg's study of behavioral psychology as a byproduct of his study of computer science. And so I think that a lot of the areas where there will be not just job growth, but really high-end job growth, will be in those mashup areas where there's a combination of an understanding of things that are scientific and technological with domain expertise that we identify as one of the humanities.
Okay. Hi. I really appreciate your framing between, you know, utopia versus dystopia, and I actually I whiplash between the two myself, thinking about the future. I'd like to get your ideas about, like, what are the policy areas that we should really be thinking about to make things less dystopian? When you talk about a nation state, you know, what is an economy? Is an economy really a state economy, or is it really economic actors who are, as has always been, exploiting folks for their own economic gain? And what should we be thinking about, and how do we use that ethics piece of ourselves?
So let me indulge me on this, because this gets me really spun up. I think we need a new social contract. I mean, the first social contract in the West was feudalism during the agricultural age, where the nobility held the lands for the crown in exchange for military service and taxation, and the peasants then lived on the land of the nobility in exchange for a percentage of their crops. Then with industrialization, that shifted, and a new social contract, a new relationship between state, capital, and labor emerged. And there were things like the 40-hour work week, pensions, health insurance, free public education until you're age 18. This was the social contract that emerged during industrialization. But what people forget is that there was this period from 1800 to 1840 called the Engels Pause. And from 1800 to 1840, there was this enormous technological innovation that took place that wildly accelerated industrialization, but things didn't get any better for people in the working class. What happened? Well, there were intellectual byproducts like communism. The Communist Manifesto was written in 1848. The largest wave of revolutions in Europe's history took place. And eventually, what really rebalanced the relationship between state, capital, and labor during industrialization was a new social contract. I think we're in sort of the Engels pause of the information age. We're in a period where technological change has happened really quickly and has significantly disrupted the relationship between state, capital, and labor. But our public policy solutions are all about how do we graft, how do we make this industrial age program work in the information age? It's like, oh, well, Uber drivers should unionize. Oh, well, we should, you know, it's all inherently regressive, as opposed to thinking about what the new relationship between state capital and labor should be. And so what are some of the policy, you know, what are some of the policies? I'll just give one example, education. So the way the state decided it would play a role in education is saying, you know what, you can have free education until you're 18 years old. And that was fine. So long as at the age of 18 with a high school degree, you could get a job in a port, factory, mine, or mill, right? Have a middle class job. We need to be thinking completely differently about education now, where we know that because of the pace of change, we have to be lifelong learners. And we have to make sure that the outputs from our education system map to the inputs of where job growth will be. So I think education is in many respects the most difficult to reform, but also by the same token, the most important. And when I do look at the states and societies that have really done a brilliant job pivoting into today and tomorrow's industries, Scandinavian economies, Singaporean and others, they're ones who 10, 12, 15 years ago made massive reforms in what we would call K-12 education. And so I think we can look broadly at this, but I do think that the organizing unit for long-term economic viability starts with education. And then I do think that within a lot of our policymaking generally, we need to be thinking not about how do we graft this industrial age set of statutes and regulations and make it work in the context of completely different business models. Yeah, no, it's hard.
And when you go to that museum, it is an entire case about people dragging value out of people who have less power.
Yep.
Education is not going to do that. So when you're looking at a social contract, mm-hmm. when you don't have those controls on it, and do we have an opportunity because of data, because of technology, to shift those controls?
Yeah, you know, I don't know that we will have it because of data and technology. You know, I think I would love to be more wide-eyed and idealistic about it, but I think ultimately the levers for power, unless, you know, capital, when it is in a position that is demonstrably dominant to the power of labor, which I think that if you just look at what household incomes have been over the last 30 years disaggregated by, you know, 1% middle class, low income, what you've seen is the relationship between capital and labor has gotten out of whack over the last 30 years. I don't think there's anything about technology or data which can rebalance that. I think ultimately it's the role of the state, meaning government, that sets the rules of the road for the relationship between state, capital, and labor. So I don't think we can hack our way into a rebalanced relationship between capital and labor. I'm sorry that I'm not more idealistic about it, but I would be dishonest if I weren't. And so that's what brings me back to, you gotta develop a new social contract, which oftentimes means new laws, new regulations. I don't know how else to do it. I think I've got time for one more question.
One more, okay.
One more.
Thank you for your talk. Can you comment on the current direction of U.S. international trade policy? Specifically, are you concerned at all on what appears a direction we're going into? And what do you think the U.S. government should be focusing on in the international trade space? Thank you.
So I'm very concerned. I think the principal political and economic binary of the 20th century was right versus left. But the principal political and economic binary of today and tomorrow's world is open versus closed. You know, I think that if you want to understand Brexit, if you want to understand the last presidential election, if you want to understand sort of the litigation around trade policy right now, for me, the sort of binary of left versus right doesn't make sense anymore. It's much more, I think, illuminating to think about it in terms of open versus closed. And what I do think is that the states and societies that are more open will be where capital and innovation congregates. And whether it's Sydney, Shanghai, Seoul, San Francisco, London, Dubai, Tel Aviv, what scares me a little bit is I think that people in those cities have more in common with one another than they do oftentimes with the people in the interior in their country. I think people in San Francisco and Sydney and Seoul have more in common with each other than they do with people in my native West Virginia. That is partly a byproduct of trade policy. Because while trade policy, I think if you take an intellectually honest view of what trade policy can do, is it is a relatively open trade policy enables upward economic mobility broadly defined. And this is why I'm in favor of most trade agreements. But what we have to, but the shortcoming over the last three decades has been that we undercorrected for what the negative impact would be in the historic centers of industry and manufacturing in the United States. And now I think we're overcorrecting for it. You know, we are now saying no more trade agreements. We're saying we're going to build walls instead of bridges. And I think that macroeconomically, that's ultimately not in our favor. I think we need to continue to be drivers of global markets and global supply chains. What we have to do is stop undercorrecting for disaffected communities and start overcorrecting for what the impacts there are going to be. So with that, thank you for your questions. I think I'm available to sign some books. Is that right, Davis?
Yeah, we'll have the signing line right here. If you have, I guess, any additional questions, I know there's some more hands. But let's thank Alec so much for coming out tonight.